all out there in Zoom land. Welcome for our next speaker in the lineup of virtual talks that we are holding in conjunction with African American Art in the 20th Century. That's our present exhibition, special exhibition at the Wichita Art Museum. It's on a national tour organized by the Smithsonian American Art Museum, and we're pretty thrilled to have it in Wichita. I'm Patricia McDonald, director at the Wichita Art Museum, and we're going to have this show on view through May 23rd, but I encourage all of you who haven't come already, at least spring break, which is right around the corner, come see the show. The talk tonight is given by John Edwin Mason. He's going to be speaking on the sounds they saw, artists, photographers, and jazz. Really excited to welcome John back to the Wichita audience. I'll talk about that in a minute. But before sharing an introduction on Dr. Mason, I always want to acknowledge the wonderful people, the great businesses in Wichita that gives financial support so that we're able to do special exhibitions like this. And really a nice number of people step forward to help us. So have a bit of patience with me. Our presenting sponsors include the Koch Family Foundation and Emprise Bank. We have additional generous support from Louise Barron, the Berry Foundation, DeVore Foundation, Sharon and Alan Feary, Sonia Gretiman and Chris Brunner, the Gridley Family Foundation, Kristen and Will Price, and Julie and Bill Nicholson. All exhibitions and public programs this year are supported by the Downing Foundation, yay, Paula and Barry, and all exhibitions here at our museum receive sponsorship from the Friends of the Wichita Art Museum and the City of Wichita. I also want to take a moment and just acknowledge a current citywide museum partnership that is happening. So we have this exhibition at the Wichita Art Museum, but we've linked arms with the Kansas African American Museum and the Ulrich Museum of Art at Wichita State University. All of us are presenting rich, strong, really compelling exhibitions of art by African Americans. So I heartily support you going out and seeing all these shows around Wichita. We have different closing dates. I think the first at TCAM is April 24th, but no time like the present. Go soon, see the wealth of African American art that's now featured in the city of Wichita. So eager, I'm really eager for this evening's talk that rounds out topics and cultural experiences that have connection to our exhibition of African American art. And thinking about kind of a further reach led us to remember and then invite John Edwin Mason. He's a person and a scholar who's becoming better and better known in Wichita in the past couple of years. This will be his third presentation to us. Dr. Mason, he's on the faculty, I think you saw in the previous slides, he's on the faculty in the history department at the University of Virginia in Richmond. His connection to Wichita is he's working on a book that's going to be a cultural biography on the important photographer Gordon Parks, who was a native Kansan and whose special collections, in part thanks to Ted Ayers, who I know is out there in Zoom land, are now part of the archives at Wichita State University. So he's in the middle, he's writing in the book. I was talking to him the other day, you know, please tell me you're right at the end. No, he's at the middle, so we still have to wait. He gave a talk in 2016 on Gordon Parks when the three museums, the Kansas African American Museum, the Ulrich, and the Wichita Art Museum, all did exhibition projects related to Gordon Parks. He spoke this past fall, November 20, on the relationship between Gordon Parks and Muhammad Ali. It was really wonderful. I learned so much by listening to Dr. Mason. So he's clearly thinking about how photographers reflect Black experience in the United States. And he's such a good, engaging speaker that we thought about him in conjunction with this show. It just so happened that additionally, Dr. Mason is a very accomplished musician. And in addition to that, he's a historian of jazz, and he contributes with some, I don't know if I'd say regularity, maybe he can characterize that for us, but he contributes to a journal on Duke Ellington. Well, you put that all together, and that made him pretty great as a person to invite to be part of our series to explore. This evening, he's going to look at artistic representations of jazz, most especially some of those that you see by Romare Bearden in our present exhibition at the Wichita Art Museum. He has a master's degree and a doctorate from Yale University. His scholarship and teaching focus are on African history, South African history, slavery, as well as photography and jazz. And if you think about that, that's such a reach. He's authored several books, countless journal articles, and interestingly, he's performed with multiple symphony orchestras in Virginia. This guy has more energy, obviously, and talent than any ordinary human being. And he's joined us for this wonderful Zoom talk. So I'm sort of passing the baton or the Zoom lens over to you, John. Thank you for joining us this evening. Can't wait to hear what you're going to share.
Well, thank you very, very much for that introduction. And you've really put the pressure on me, I have to say, to give you a good evening's worth of entertainment. I am a friend of Wichita. I've fallen in love with Wichita over the last 5 or 6 years. I've made several trips out there, and partly to give talks and partly to work in the Gordon Parks papers that are at the special collections of the Wichita State University Library. And I have to say, those librarians take beautiful care of those papers. And when you come to work on Gordon Parks, they treat you like a king. So I'm, you know, like all of us, I'm had enough of this pandemic, and I think my Wi-Fi is going in and out, and that's just something that we're going to have to live with this evening, because my Wi-Fi does go in and out. I've had enough of this pandemic, I know we all have, but it has deprived me of 2 trips to Kansas this year, and so I'm especially mad at it. So I do want to talk about the relationship between art, especially photography, but not only photography, and jazz. And I want to talk about the way that artists have been moved by the music in several different ways. It is a subject matter, right? So Romare Bearden has painted pictures of jazz musicians, and the photographers I'm going to talk about have taken pictures of jazz musicians. But it's more than that. It's been an inspiration. It's been an inspiration both in terms of how artists work, the process of producing their art, whether it's a collage by Bearden or a photograph by Roy de Carava. Jazz has inspired their working processes, and I'll say a little bit about that. But jazz has also been something to aspire to. I've got a great quote from a living photographer, a guy called Danny Dawson, whose work is right now being exhibited at the Whitney in New York. And Danny gave me such a great quote about how jazz musicians aspired achievement that I don't want to spoil that quote. So I'm not going to say too much about that. And having sort of warmed you up, I'm going to share my screen and get right into it. Okay, the sounds they saw. As you'll see, I'm stealing that, I'm stealing my title from Roy de Carava, but I hope he wouldn't mind about that. I actually want to start with somebody I haven't mentioned yet. I want to start with Langston Hughes. Langston Hughes, the great poet, playwright, novelist, memoirist, certainly one of America's great writers of the 20th century. You know, he enters into my story in a variety of different ways. In the 1940s, Gordon Parks collaborated with him on a little project in Chicago. In the 1950s, Roy de Carava, photographer I'll talk about, collaborated with him on the publication of a book, Roy de Carava's photographs with Langston Hughes text. And then in the 1960s, Hughes became a mentor for a group of photographers that I'll talk about later. They called themselves the Komoinge Workshop. And so he was a mentor, he was a collaborator, but he was also somebody who loved jazz and he was into jazz and whose poetry in many ways tried to emulate jazz. By the way, I'll just say that this portrait you're looking at here is by Lou Draper, who was a member of that Komoinge workshop and who, as a very young man, rented a room in Langston Hughes' Harlem brownstone. So there are all kinds of connections here. They're really wonderful. So, you know, Hughes took the beat of poetry, took the beat of jazz into his poetry. And, you know, you can hear it so easily. Good morning, Daddy. Ain't you heard the boogie woogie wumble of a dream deferred? Yeah, well, that dream deferred is also going to come back to us, you know, that here Hughes has taken the rhythms of jazz and made it part of his poetry. But he's also, in the last line there, introduced something a little deeper and perhaps a little darker. You can certainly see it in this poem, tinkling treble, rolling bass, high noon teeth and a midnight face, great long fingers on great big hands, screaming petals where his 12 shoe lands. Looks like his eyes are teasing pain, a few minutes late for the freedom train. You know, freedom is going to be a recurring theme. I'm not going to hammer away on it, but jazz was the music of freedom, but freedom in a variety of different senses, and certainly in the political sense. The musicians and the artists who were inspired by it understood freedom in the political sense, as in freedom for the African-American people. It also meant artistic freedom. It meant individual freedom. It meant a lot of different things. And so here is Langston Hughes, in his way, writing what seems to be light poetry, drawing on jazz for his rhythms. And yet, so, like so much of jazz, there's something much deeper than what there might seem to be on the surface. Sonny Rollins, the great tenor player, jazz wasn't just music, it was a social force. And it was talking about freedom. Sonny Rollins, I guess, came to popular acclaim in the 1950s. He's still alive. He's not playing anymore, but he's still very much alive. But in the 50s and 60s, you know, coinciding with the high point of the civil rights movement, jazz was one of the soundtracks to that movement. It certainly wasn't the only soundtrack. People were listening to R&B and soul, but jazz was there. And you know, and especially among artists and intellectuals and writers, you know, it was very much a part of it. So here, back to freedom, Ingrid Munson, really fabulous writer about jazz, a scholar of jazz, you know, the art music variously known. Jazz has many names: jazz, swing, bebop, America's classical music, creative music. Whatever you want to call it, it's always been associated first and foremost with freedom. And here are those various kinds of freedom that I was talking about: freedom of expression, human freedom, freedom of thought, and the freedom that results from an ongoing pursuit of racial justice. Jazz has always been there, and that ongoing pursuit of racial justice is not necessarily always on the surface, not in the art that jazz inspired and not in the music itself. But it is something that will be flavoring all of the things that we look at tonight. And here's that slide about how many people have been influenced by jazz, and especially intellectuals and artists, and that continues to be true today. In Duke Ellington's time, Count Basie's time, jazz was popular music, right? It was the popular music of the day. It isn't anymore, and hasn't been since the 1950s, but it still has an audience, and a very intense audience. And so jazz has always attracted intellectuals and artists. That's true. The music's influence can be felt far from the bandstand, the dance floor, and the recording studio. And I was thinking about this and just coming up, well, off the top of my head, with artists and writers who have been, and other musicians who have been inspired by jazz, and Mondrian, Matisse, Picasso, Jackson Pollock, Ralph Ellison, the writer, Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, Gershwin, Ravel, Millot, Leonard Bernstein, Kurt Weill, and, you know, coming very much up to the present. So, you know, jazz from the 50s, 60s, 70s, jazz from the 21st century is being sampled and inspires people like The Roots, Kendrick Lamar, and Beyonce. So, you know, jazz may no longer be a popular music, but it continues to be a really, really powerful music. But it's also fun, and I wanted to emphasize that jazz is fun. You know, the primary reason that people will listen to jazz is it makes them happy, man. It makes them feel good, and it moves them and inspires them. And so here's Romare Bearden, and I'll be talking about him in a second. Jazz has shown me ways of achieving artistic structures. Yeah, absolutely. But it also provides me continuing finger-snapping, head-shaking enjoyment. Yeah, never want to forget the fun. Forget the fun of jazz. So we know what jazz photography is supposed to look like. And when I say that, I am not condemning William Gottlieb at all. William Gottlieb invented the cliches. He really did. I mean, he's one of probably two people who invented the great cliches of jazz photography. And the cliches that the people I'm talking about went out of their way to avoid. But, you know, we had the jazz hipster during the bebop era, late 40s, early 50s, you know, the sunglasses, the beret, that kind of thing. We had the cigarette smoke in dark nightclubs. And here's Django Reinhardt. And Gottlieb, bless his heart, he's not reproducing cliches and stereotypes. He's inventing them, right? So we've got to give him credit for that. But these images spread and shape the way that people understood jazz, in part because they just showed up in the media. They were used for publicity photos. They showed up in magazines devoted to jazz, as you can see here, Downbeat Magazine, which is still being published today. So those ideas of what a jazz musician should look like. There was a photographer, Gijon Mili, who was an immigrant from Albania who soared to the top of the American photography profession. He worked for Life magazines on the staff. He did a series of articles for Jazz Magazine, for Life magazine, photo essays for Life magazine that were staged nightclubs. They weren't really nightclubs, but he took a studio and turned it into a nightclub with all kinds of dramatic lighting, and reproduced those images that are now cliche about the dark nightclub, the cigarette smoke, the saxophones, and the trumpets. After he did the stories for Life, he made a movie, and here's a still. I've just forgotten Prez's real name. Any case, this is Prez, Mr. Pork Pie Hat. It'll come to me in just a second. And, you know, you've all seen photographs like that, right? And so what the artists and photographers that I'm going to be talking about were doing was in part trying to invent a new language for photographing jazz, but also to try to photograph other things, right? To photograph not just the musician in performance, but we want to try to go deeper, right? We want to see what else we can find in the music. Now, one of the people who found it is somebody I'm not going to say very much about, but I am going to acknowledge that Gene Smith, one of the great photographers of the 20th century. I mean, any list of great photographers, your top five from the 20th century, Eugene Smith is going to be on everybody's list. He was that good. He's born and raised in Wichita. Born and raised in Wichita. And the last time I was in Wichita, I couldn't find a statue of Gene Smith anywhere. And so somebody out there in my audience today, I mean, this is your job. You've got to erect a memorial to Gene Smith because he was a fabulous photographer. You know, he was known for so many things as a documentary photographer, as having made some of the most powerful photography to come out of World War II. He saw combat. He was very seriously injured. A documentary photographer in the 50s and 60s, doing some incredibly important and moving work. But he also loved jazz. He loved jazz. He was maniacal about jazz. He had a loft in New York that he turned into a hangout and rehearsal space for musicians. And God love him. I mean, he had it wired for sound. He had lights all over. And they were there, and they were happy to be there because he gave them free rehearsal space and a place to hang out. And he liked having them because he really loved the music and because he loved making the photography. And you can already see that we're in a different kind of photography here, right? You know, he's not going for images that you've seen a million times about jazz. So here he is with Thelonious Monk, the great composer and pianist. And then you can see from this picture that we've really shifted gears far away from the cliche and stereotype of what jazz photography is all about. So an acknowledgement to, hats off to Gene Smith, born and raised in Wichita, and now to a guy who was born and raised in Fort Scott, Kansas. Fort Scott is my second favorite town in Kansas. I've spent a lot of time there. Gordon Parks was born and raised there until he was 15. The Gordon Parks Museum is there. The people are incredibly friendly and helpful, and I've really enjoyed it. Duke Ellington has always been my hero. Parks was not exaggerating, and he was not making things up all of his life. One of the things about Gordon Parks is that he gave so many interviews. And he wrote not one, not two, not three, but four memoirs that you can sort of trace what he was thinking virtually any moment in his life. And one of the consistent things is that Duke Ellington was always been one of his heroes. So here's a really early picture by Gordon Parks, 1944. So Parks had had a difficult young adulthood. A really difficult young adulthood. After his mother died, the family dispersed and he went to live with an older sister and her husband in St. Paul, Minnesota. Never really found his feet. You know, his brother-in-law disliked him tremendously, threw him out of the house. Parks had to support himself from the time he was 15. He did. Never finished high school. Worked a long series of dead-end jobs in his teens, all through his 20s. Couldn't seem to find his direction, but you know, he was very, very smart, very talented in a variety of things, and he just needed to find that thing that was going to lift him out of desperate poverty. It was while he was working on the railroad. He was working as a dining car waiter. That's one of those jobs that was open to African Americans. You know, so many doors had been slammed in his face because of the color of his skin. But dining car waiter, well, that was a job for Black people, and he had it, or for Black men, and he had it. But he started seeing copies of magazines, picture magazines, like Vogue, like Vanity Fair, like Life, like Look. And he started being captivated by the power of photography. And he bought a camera. And he clearly showed talent from the very beginning. From the very beginning, he showed talent. The other thing he had was an immense capacity for hard work and a driving ambition. So if you've got talent, capacity for hard work, and a lot of ambition, you're probably going to go places. And he went places. One of the places he went was to the Office of War Information, the OWI. That was a documentary project during World War II that was run by a guy who had been running a documentary project for the government during the Depression, a guy called Roy Stryker. It was one of the places you wanted to go. I mean, this was a big break for Parks. And it's here that he develops, one of the places he develops his skill as a photographer. I mean, it's very unusual for an African-American to have a position with an organization like the OWI, but it was like going to grad school. I mean, it was like really getting your chops together. So here's a very good picture of Duke Ellington. And you can sense Park's admiration for Ellington and his sense of connection with Ellington in this picture. It's a good picture. And at the same time, still working for the OWI, he took some pictures of the musicians from Ellington's orchestra, and you know, it's good, perfectly adequate. And Parks was thrilled to be there, right? He's still a young man and he's with his hero. And I love the way that he describes what Ellington meant to him. Unlike Black Hollywood stereotypes, he never grinned. He smiled. He never shuffled. He strode. It was always, "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen." Never, "How y'all doing?" At his performances, we young blacks sat high in our seats, wanting whites to see us, to know that this handsome, elegant, sharply dressed man playing that beautiful, sophisticated music was one of us. Okay. This handsome, elegant, sharply dressed man. Well, you know, one of the things that Parks learned from Ellington and from others was his own personal sense of style. This portrait is probably from the mid-1940s, this self-portrait of Gordon Parks. And I got to tell you, in the mid-1940s, he didn't have any money. He did not have any money, and he knew how to dress. He really did. And people who know him, Ted Ayers is out there laughing. I know this. Parks always knew how to dress. I mean, he was always sophisticated. He was always stylish. He was always cosmopolitan. And you can see it here. But you know, Parks, as a young man, took a certain kind of photograph of Duke Ellington. But when he made it to life, and he made it to the staff of life, life sent him out on the road with the Ellington Orchestra. And the photographs are so different. I mean, they're quiet, and they're not necessarily about performance. Right? So this is about Ellington the thinker. This is about Ellington the artist. This is about Ellington the composer, right? This is a man who's deeply engaged in his art form. And the pictures that he's taking on stage, they're not the obvious ones. I know that now in 2021, we've seen a bunch of photographs of performers that look more or less like this. But you hadn't in 1960. This wasn't the way that you photographed Duke Ellington in 1960. You know, when you photographed Duke Ellington, you didn't shoot him from behind. You shot him from the front. You wanted to see his face. And here, this is as much about light and shadow as it is about Duke Ellington. And I think that this would stand as a photograph, even if we didn't know that the man hunched over the piano was Duke. And similarly here, you know, that in and of itself, this is not necessarily an outstanding photograph, but in a series, it really works, right? So who is this man when he's not on stage? Who is this man when he's not composing? Who is this man when he's alone in his hotel room? Who is this man? And, you know, Parks is giving us a sense of that here. And then finally, this is one of my favorite photographs of Ellington that Parks did. And, you know, it's just because, you know, it's a photograph of a TV screen, but it also captures Billy Strayhorn. Strayhorn was Ellington's great collaborator. Strayhorn wrote many of the songs that you associate with Duke Ellington. He wrote The A-Train. He wrote Lush Life. He was a fabulous musician, composer, arranger, but chose to stay in the background. And he and Ellington had a very, very, very close partnership, musical partnership. And, you know, to see them two together here, but in a sort of secondary way, right? A virtual, they're connecting virtually, as you and I are tonight. So, you know, Parks was definitely part of a trend of a photographer and artist inspired by jazz, but also looking not necessarily to do the obvious thing. So Romare Bearden, Well, I chose Bearden for a couple of reasons. For one thing, he's part of the exhibition that's at the museum right now, and he's a great artist. He's a great artist who was moved and influenced by jazz in several different ways. Remember, we saw the quote earlier where he said, "I really liked the music, it was fun." He also was another mentor for the Camoingue workshop photographers. I'll talk about them in a few minutes. And so Bearden's, you know, I'm gonna show you examples of his work where he's using jazz musicians as subject matter, but what he got from them was much more than being a subject matter. So here he is talking about some of that. "I played around with visual notions as if I were improvising like a jazz musician." That word improvisation, boy, it's going to come back. And artists and photographers sensed that connection, especially a certain kind of art and a certain kind of photography where you're not in the studio, you're not taking 20 minutes to set up a shot, but you're shooting spontaneously. And what Bearden wanted to do was to work spontaneously. And that's not always what painters and graphic artists do, right? It's a more considered, planned out process. But he's trying to find a way to improvise. He wants to be more like a jazz musician. And you know, some of the work that he did, coming to this surprisingly late in life, actually. So, you know, here we see, you know, the trombonist from some band or another. I don't think they're supposed to be a particular band, but the brass section, you know, there is obviously a looseness to the composition and to his strokes, and he's working fast, and he's trying to capture that improvisational quality. Another one where we have a sense that this isn't carefully planned. He doesn't have a dozen sketches of this artwork that he has started it. He's going to work fast. He's going to be inspired by it. I think both of these that I've just shown you are at the museum right now, and that would be really cool to go look at them. You listen to a lot of music, and here he's going to be, he's alluding to another one of the things that he did was to create collages, right? So he's talking about sheets of paper, make some lines, do some cutting, put things together to collage, and thinking that might help him work faster, right? And he's saying it's a kind of shorthand. I want to pick up on the rhythms, the musical interviews of jazz. So here's one of his collages, you know, put together in a variety of different ways, in part from things that he had painted, paper that he had found, paper that he had cut, putting together these shapes. There's this, I think he was going for a kind of looseness and once again, speed. And then I think one of my favorites, I tweeted this the other day. If you want to buy me a birthday present for my next birthday, it should be this. It was recently auctioned, this has been reproduced as posters, but the original, the collage on Masonite, was recently auctioned at the Swan Galleries. I don't know what it sold for, but if you'd like to buy it for me, start saving now. but this is paper. It's a collage of cut paper. And once again, you know, loose, fast, and, you know, he's alluding to things. You know, we kind of fill in the gaps, right? The shapes are very basic, and yet we see it all. We can almost hear it all. Back to photography. So, Roy de Caraba, tremendously underrated. You know, he is a photographer who has work at the Museum of Modern Art, Metropolitan Museum, Art Institute of Chicago, you know, major museums in the United States, but also all over the world. I mean, he was a great photographer, and yet still unsung, still too little known. There are reasons for that that I want to go into, but he is too little known. But I think as much as anyone, he's a photographer that despite the tremendous range of his work, one associates with a jazz aesthetic, a really thoughtful, self-conscious jazz aesthetic. Now, he was a working photographer, and so he'd do anything. I mean, he made portraits. He freelanced for Sports Illustrated, had some covers for Sports Illustrated, did commercial photography, you know, anything to earn a living. But when he was doing his own work, when he wasn't photographing for pay, when he was pursuing his art, he did one of two things. I mean, he was a street photographer, that is to say, literally shooting on the streets, unrehearsed, unplanned, trying to catch life on the fly, and also jazz. And here's that word again, improvisation. So jazz rooms are so dark, there's never enough light. Supposedly there's not enough light. So I have to improvise. I'm doing what the jazzmen are doing, see? I'm operating in the moment. If you want to see more of his work, I mean, this book, The Sound I Saw, and of course, this is where I stole my title for the night, The Sound I Saw, you know, all of these artists and photographers are trying to do something really very elusive, right? To translate something as insubstantial as music. You know, music has no physical form. I mean, it's sound waves that come and go. Mostly they go, right? They don't stay around. They're trying to translate this elusive thing and make it visible, right? To see the invisible. And they're all doing that. I think that phrase, the sound I saw, is really potent. His collaboration with John Coltrane was long-lasting and deep and personal. They were friends. You know, it started out with De Caraba, who basically is the same age as John Coltrane, being sort of his acolyte, being a fanboy. But, you know, they were two great artists, and they recognized each other as great artists. Coltrane was always happy to have De Caraba around. And what De Caraba, we'll see in another quote in just a second, that De Caraba is going for something that's different and deeper than just making pictures of musicians on stage. And he also had a style. You know, you can see a De Caraba photograph almost instantaneously, because he didn't mind how dark he went. He really did not. You know, his shadows are very dark, and sometimes details are hidden in the shadows. And, you know, he had to use a relatively long shutter speed because it's a very dark nightclub and things moved around. And so this blurriness is Coltrane in performance, moving around. That's part of what De Caraba was accepting. But as I was saying, he was going beyond performance. I photograph musicians as people. It's not necessary to photograph them while they're playing. What I respond to is their commitment to what they're doing, the intensity they bring to life at that moment. Right? So commitment, intensity, these are things that you hear a lot when you're talking to photographers, artists who are talking about jazz. You know, something I admire in people, and of course all people do it, but jazz musicians happen to do it much more intensely. So you've got darkness, you've got going for something frankly spiritual, and so here's Milt Jackson, the great vibes player, and you know, it's a moment of repose. It's a moment that also accepts darkness, you know, especially in the bottom of the frame, we kind of lose things, can't really make out the details of his jacket. This is so nice, Late Night Singer. We don't know who she is. This is De Caraba's title, Late Night Singer, so we really don't know who she is. But we see just enough of her, right? Just enough of her emerging out of that darkness. And of course, just enough of the piano. So microphone, piano, we know where we are, but it's a photograph that sort of revels in its refusal to be crystal clear and to reveal its secrets. And here, you know, the woman in the white dress just emerging out of total darkness, a little bit of the man. But it's enough to tell us. It's enough to tell us what's going on. And it's enough to tell us about the relationship between the couple. Such a gorgeous photograph. Wow. So, Komoenge. I'm going to talk about Komoenge in part because I know a lot of the Komoenge photographers. I've written about Komoenge, done research on Komoenge. But also because they're at the Whitney Museum right now. They're at the Whitney Museum. And this is a screenshot from the Whitney Museum's website. So you can, in fact, go see the Komoenge exhibition until the end of this month. This is an exhibition that started at the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts, the VMFA in Richmond. It was curated by Sarah Eckhart, who did a spectacular job of not simply recovering the work and the story of the Komoenge workshop, but showing how it really matters. I mean, it's one of the most spectacular jobs of curation that I have seen in a very long time, and I want to give Sarah Eckhart her due. So this is the Komoenge workshop. This is them when they were all young. This is probably the very end of the 60s or the very beginning of the 70s. And the Komoenge came together in the early 1960s. And they had a mission to speak of our lives as only we can. That is to counter, to challenge, to overturn the cliches, the stereotypes, the untruths that saturated the media about African-American people. You all know those cliches and stereotypes, and they wanted to challenge them. They're doing this in the early 60s, remember? So, you know, we haven't even had the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act at this point. The other reason they came together is because Black photographers were excluded from the media industry. You know, except for Gordon Parks, you were not going to get a job at a magazine. There were no African-American photographers working for major newspapers. It was only after Komoenge staged essentially a revolt that Roy Nicaragua started working for Newsweek and Sports Illustrated. So they came together as mutual support, and they became something of a family. And one of the ways that they became a family is because, as Sean Walker is saying here, they were all jazz fanatics. They loved jazz. And Komoenge's way of working was, you know, everybody had either a day job or they were working somewhere teaching photography in high schools, or they were working in camera stores, or they were darkroom technicians somewhere. They all had 9-to-5 jobs or 8-to-5 jobs, but they'd get together on Sundays and they would show what have you been shooting during the week, right? And there was always music, there was always food, and there was always critique, right? Trying to make themselves better photographers. And, you know, one of the ways that they learned how to work on their craft, how to work on their art, was through emulating jazz. And I'll get to that great quote I mentioned earlier by Danny Dawson. So these photographs are from earlier in the Komoenge photographers' careers. These are from their first 10 or 15 years as a photographer. Many of them are still alive. Many of them are still making photographs. And they've changed and they've evolved and they've developed. And here with Herb Robinson's Miles Davis, you can see what it owes to Roy Nicaragua, right? You know, the darkness, the shadows, the indistinctness, the not worrying about how in focus it is. And here's Buford Smith. And, you know, saying that they're looking for ways around the cliches. They're looking for ways to show you something else and to do something else. Yeah, this is about two jazz bass players, no doubt about that. But this is also about light and shadow and shape and form. And that's also what it's about. I mean, they were self-consciously making art at the same time that they were talking about that they were photographing jazz or musicians. And so here's that Danny Dawson quote that I'm going to read because it's so good. Our highest models of artistic creation were the musicians. They weren't necessarily the visual artists. Sure, we were all influenced by Eugene Smith, Cartier-Bresson, the French photographer, Roy Nicaragua, Gordon Parks, but our strongest influences, Miles Davis, Duke Ellington, Thelonious Monk, Charlie Parker, John Coltrane. This is the sentence. The highest standards of excellence we had in the Black community were the musicians. They showed us what could be done and we had to strive to reach it. Yeah, that's such a great quote. I'm going to start moving quickly because I just checked the time. And, you know, here's Coltrane. In the history of jazz and the history of photography, John Coltrane is inescapable because he was such a towering genius. But, you know, they weren't just doing, you know, musicians on stage or music. You know, there's a guy playing out on the street. And here's Draper taking the picture. He just happens to be standing in front of a mural where you have heroes of African-American history. So you've got the trombone player, you've got the mural, you've got also Draper, once again, working on grayscale, working on shape, working on composition. You know, this is a really incredibly fine photograph. Adger Cowens, the singer, sort of fading or emerging from that Dacaravian darkness. Betty Carter, you know, and then once again, what is this about, right? I mean, this isn't about performance. This is about something else. It's about a moment in time. Lionel Hampton, slow shutter speed, moving, but capturing that exuberance, that life, that energy. It's just stunning. If you know jazz, you would recognize Bill Evans instantaneously, even though you can't see almost anything at all, right? And Adger Cowens, once again, sort of giving us a sense of where it all starts. And where it all starts is kids at home, learning how to play their instruments, being inspired by the community and those who have gone before. Sorry about that. So, you know, everything I've shown you more or less in photography has been in black and white. And that's because, you know, until the 70s, if you were doing serious photography, you did black and white. There was almost a taboo against doing color. Color meant you were shooting commercially. Color meant you were shooting for Life or for Time or for Sports Illustrated. Color was not for serious artistic work. It all sounds silly now, but in fact, that's what people thought. The other thing, of course, about color is that developing and printing it is very hard. And it got easier and cheaper later in the century, and especially with the coming of digital photography, it was very cheap and very easy. But it wasn't back when the Komonge photographers were starting out. And so you did black and white because you could develop it and print it at home in your kitchen. But sometimes you had an assignment and they wanted it in color. And so here's some Lou Draper with Miles Davis, and getting Miles Davis at those quiet moments. It's really, even this performance slide looks quiet, you know, and it's certainly not the kind of image that would have shown up in Downbeat magazine at the time. Miles in a quiet moment. There was some other color. And here's Herb Robinson, you know, just once again, alluding to things, not spelling it out. We're not even sure until we make out that's really a piano. So coming to the end, here's Ingrid Monson again, writing with Gerald Early. And the ultimate thing linking jazz photography, Black creator, is the element of reality. Jazz music emanates from the reality of the musician's life experiences. In photography, there's the undeniable reality of the thing in front of the lens and the film that takes the image. Yeah, there's chemistry involved. There's physics of light involved. There is a reality there. Those realities equally welcome the embrace of the ungilded reality of the Black man's experience in a hostile racial environment. Hostile racist environment. You know, I said that this is going to be an undercurrent in everything that I showed you, and in all of these photographs, one of the undercurrents is to recreate how African Americans are represented in American visual culture. There's always in the back of the artist's mind a knowledge of what those hostile racial stereotypes and cliches look like. The mammies and the step and fetchets, you know, the black brood or the Jezebel. They were there, and they're trying to counter those images, which were still so prevalent in the 1950s and the 1960s. I think they're making a really good point here. But, you know, there's no question that jazz is a really patriarchal art form. You know, there have been many, many, many great women jazz musicians, but boy, they have had to fight. They have had to overcome obstacles. It's also true that photography has been a very patriarchal industry. Lots of great women photographers, but boy, they've had to fight. And thirdly, it's true that jazz fandom is kind of a guy thing, you know? You know, the real fans, you know, especially the ones who show up with cameras. It's a guy thing. Yeah, but not entirely. And so I want to end with Ming Smith. Ming was the woman that you saw in that group portrait of the Camoingue photographers. So Ming's been around for quite a while. A self-portrait here that she did in 1972 as a straight photograph, and they had reprinted and painted on it in 2019. So an old photograph with new, what do you want to call them, annotations by herself. I really, really love this portrait. And Ming was fully capable of doing a more or less conventional jazz photograph. Here, Dexter Gordon, yeah, we've seen this before. You know, probably you'd want to crop it, you know, to make him a little bigger in the frame. But yeah, we've seen this kind of thing before. You know, what she was really after was something spiritual, you know, and she talks about it. I've talked to her about it. You know, that when she saw Sun Ra, she wasn't blown away by this man and by his band. And Sun Ra was very into mysticism and very into the spiritual. And Ming is too, and she sensed a kindred spirit, and she wanted to capture the mystery of the music that he was making, the mystery of the man himself. She wasn't interested in literally telling you, what does he look like? What does his band look like? She's showing us what she felt and what she saw in him. This is part of two, and the other one is when he turned around and went the other way. And so, you know, you don't even know what you're looking at, right? Unless you're deep, deep into jazz and you'd recognize the Sun Ra on one of his robes. But, you know, when you see this in the sequence of the two and you understand where Ming is coming from, she's showing you, you know, probably a direction in jazz photography that we might not have seen or might not have other photographers haven't explored quite as much as she has. Sorry. Yeah, she was part of the scene. And so, you know, she'd have her camera with her. And if you see a photograph, you're going to make it. And it's, you know, it's this kind of photograph that is very much in the improvisational style. I suppose all of them were. But with the Sun Ra, he was performing at that moment. And she knew that sooner or later, he's going to do something that's very photogenic. And she'll make a picture of it. And here, you know, old Babs, she saw this expression. She saw this instantaneous second. And, you know, if you're a good photographer, if you have mastered your craft in the same way that a piano player has mastered his or her craft, and that's one of the things that all the photographers were doing was mastering their craft, mastering their tools. You know, you don't want to be thinking about f-stops and shutter speeds when you're making a photograph that's like this. You've got to make it. That expression doesn't last more than a fleeting second, and it's gone. And she got it. And so here is the last image that I'm going to show you tonight. And we're ending with Duke Ellington on a TV screen. I love the resonance here between the earlier Gordon Parks photo that I showed you and Ming Smith's photo here. Ming knew Parks, but not particularly well. And Parks was not really one of her photographic heroes. But certainly Ellington is Ellington. I mean, he has a special place in African-American culture and in the history of music. He is one of those towering figures. And I like the virtualness of this homage to a really great man. So I'll end it there with Ming Smith. And I'll also end it there because Duke Ellington is one of my favorite musicians. So basically, if you're guessing who are John's favorite jazz musicians, and if you were to guess John Coltrane and Duke Ellington, you would guess exactly right. So that's it. Thank you very much for coming, everybody.
Learned so much. Oh, super cool. I'm going to, we don't have questions in the chat yet, John, so I'm going to dive in with one just to start. The Kamonge group. So I'm, you know, from references and from the images that we saw, I'm assuming based in New York. I'm unfamiliar with this group, but where did the title come from?
Ah, that's a really great question. I'm sorry I didn't mention it. So New York is pervasive in this talk. I just didn't spell mm-hmm. it out. But Gordon Parks spent most of his professional life in New York City. Romare Bearden spent most of his professional life in Harlem. Roy de Carava spent much of his professional life living in Harlem. The Kamoenge photographers, many of them lived in Harlem, and in an important sense, the group is based in Harlem. Right? So we've got New York City and Harlem, and it's all through this. It's just absolutely all through this. And then, you know, I would guess that most of the photographs I showed you were made in New York. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if we took the Isle of Manhattan out of this talk, there wouldn't be very much left. So that's one thing. Kamoenge is from a Kikuyu word, and it means those who work together. So, you know, when Kamoenge was founded, it was a moment where African-American artists, intellectuals, activists are in some ways rediscovering Africa. And that's because so many African new nations were emerging. Nations which had been colonized are achieving their independence in the late 50s and into the early 60s, early to mid 60s. So there was this fascination with Africa, and, you know, and African diplomats are going to, in New York, they're going to the United Nations in Washington, D.C. They're establishing embassies there. So Africa was really on the mind of African Americans. And one of the places was Kenya. The Kenyans had fought an anti-colonial war. Jomo Kenyatta, the first president of independent Kenya, was a hero to many. And so picking a word from Kenya, from the Kikuyu language, it made sense. It made sense. And so it means those who work together.
We don't have any questions in the chat from our audience quite yet. Oh, yep, here we do. Here's one. I had one, but someone is saying, tell us a little bit more about Babs Gonzalez. I read one of her books in which stated that he was forced a record company recall a record recorded by Dizzy Gillespie because his name was not listed as the composer, and that destroyed this person's career.
This is a question for which I am supremely unprepared.
Okay.
I can't tell you anything more about Babs Gonzalez. I'm sorry.
Oh, well, this person had seemingly a lot of background, wanted a bunch. Hey, a question that I had, so, you know, little known fact about Patricia McDonald, in the late 70s and early 80s, I spent a bunch of time in blues clubs with friends who were musicians in the Bay Area, and really understood and learned there the camaraderie, the friendships, the incredible community that existed, you know, among people through performance. And your world, or the scholarship and the research that you're doing, at any rate, looks at musicians and music. And you also talked about this conscious circle of photographers who banded together with the Sunday afternoons, I'm going to imagine, but Sundays at any rate, to test one another, to sort of work out their ideas together. Where do you think they got that idea, I guess is my question. Can you talk a little bit about what you know about the community that artists create for themselves?
Yeah. Kumange came out of two different groups of photographers, and they were people who had somehow bumped into each other. You know, maybe they saw each other out on the streets photographing. Maybe one of them was working in a camera shop and got into a conversation with another. But, you know, when you're working on an art and a craft, you don't want to do it by yourself, right? you want companionship. You know, you want to learn from other people. You want maybe to be mentored. You certainly want to be pushed. You want ideas that don't just come out of your own head. You want company. You want companionship. Mm-hmm. And for African-American photographers, you know, they had to do it themselves, right? An aspiring African-American photographer in the early 1960s, you were not going to get hired by Time or Newsweek or the New York Daily News or the New York Times. They did not hire Black writers or Black photographers. And so where are you going to go? I mean, how are you going to find a community? And so I think there was, you know, not surprisingly, you know, a felt need for this. And I can't tell you exactly how people met each other, but there were two groups of photographers. One was called the 35 millimeter club, and no, Club 35 from 35 millimeter camera. The other one was nameless. But people who were in one group met people who were in the other group, and they said, why should we have two groups? Let's have one group. Let's merge. And that's when the name Kumange comes. You know, mutual support. Musicians had that, right? So that mm-hmm. if you're an aspiring jazz musician, you know, you probably learned how to play the trumpet or the trombone in school. And, you know, and then there were other young people who were making music and you were playing with them. And then you started hanging out in clubs and maybe you went to jam sessions. And if you were really, really good, then you got invited to play in a professional band. And if you were even better than that, then you got to play in a good professional band. I mean, there are ways in which there's a community of musicians out there. And a community of artists as well. You know, there were, what's the word I'm looking for? Art centers. In Harlem had a couple of different art centers, a place where people could go learn how to paint. Learn how to do graphic design, et cetera, and so on. So there was community for people in those ways. And I think that here the musicians come along and they want community too. They want company. They want mm-hmm. Friendship. They also want to organize, right? So I did say that eventually people like Roy DeCaraba do start working for Sports Illustrated, Newsweek, those kinds of places. But that's only after organizing. And one of the organizations that was putting pressure on the publishing industry to change was Kumange. Was Kumange, you know? United we stand, divided we fall, right? There's strength in numbers.
Yeah, and I would think banding together for creating exhibition opportunities together as well. You've got two, well, at least maybe two or three additional questions. I'm going to start with the first one and then, or start kind of with the second one and go to the first. Anyway, did Kumange ever associate with the Camera Club of New York? That's your first question. Your second question is a little bit more soulful. So did they associate with the Camera Club of New York? And then, John, there are so many jazz programs in colleges and universities at this point. What kind of impact do you think that that's happening on the music itself?
So I'm sorry, I've already forgotten the Kumange question.
Did they associate with the Camera Club of New York?
Not that I know of. Not that okay. I know of. Mm-hmm. I've never seen the Camera Club of New York emerge in their archives. Maybe they did, but I don't know. There is a tangential connection to the Photo League. So the Photo League actually had disbanded by the time Camoige comes along. The Photo League in the 1930s, 1940s was an avowedly anti-racist left-wing group of photographers, right? And avowedly anti-racist, avowedly left-wing. Some of the people who came out of the Photo League became mentors for members of Camoige. Not Camoige as a group, but individual members of Camoige were mentored by people who had come out of the Photo League. But I, Camera Club of New York, haven't seen it, haven't seen a mention. Jazz in the universities and in the music schools is, it's very controversial right now, very controversial within the jazz community. You know, on the one hand, it's a good thing, it's keeping the music alive, the great places to perform, income opportunities for jazz musicians to do workshops, residencies, that kind of thing. But there are a lot of people who would tell you that, you know, that it's turning the music into museum music. That this is not music that grows organically out of the African American community, or the music of the music schools does not grow organically out of the African American community. I am not deep enough into that world to to make a judgment. I'm not deep enough into it. I'll simply say that there are people who will say that one of the things that colleges and music schools have done is to disconnect the music from the Black community. And so there's contention for sure. I don't have to choose sides.
That's fascinating. I've not heard that critique before, but it seems to me that for ways that academic program like that might mute the spontaneity, the sort of rigor, the grit of the music, there's a strong potential that it also lifts someone, sort of provides an avenue for someone to discover the music, to go on to something really great.
I'm not going to argue with you on that. I think that, you know, to just put the cards on the table, most college and music school jazz programs are overwhelmingly white. And that simply rubs a lot of musicians the wrong way.
Yeah, fair. Perfectly fair. Well, John, what we're getting now in the chat is, oh my God, he was amazing. The images were fabulous. You need to speak in Wichita more often. We really, really appreciate wisdom that you brought, the incredible images, a new lens to look at the exhibition here. So goal achieved. Thanks so much, John.
Well, thank you very much. And believe me, as soon as this pandemic is over, and you know, we hope and pray that it's over very, very soon. As soon as it's over, I expect a real life invitation to Wichita.
All right. Yeah, we heard it here first. Sure thing, John. So thank you for joining us tonight. We really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure entirely.
Bye, all.